said good day, sir!
Welcome everybody here to your coverage of the defense powered by Razor as well as BenQ. We are into our groups. They're just continuing through our days where Kiet is going up against Hello Moto in one of our four games which will be coming up for you this evening. I'll be your host, Obi-Wan Kenobi, going through the game and also joining me inside the game. Let's actually jump ourselves in there right now. It will be my co-commentator. His name is Ham Sandwich. Welcome back to the broadcast, man.
Thank you. I'm excited about this game. It started on time, which is excellent. Both teams are here.
Yeah.
Plenty of time, so props to both of them.
It's good, man. It's good. It doesn't happen every day, but the days it happens, we all get to rejoice.
Yeah, and first game of the day, it sets off the day on the right foot.
That it does, man. That it does. For those guys out there, too, wondering why I sound a little bit huskier today, it's because, well, I enjoy watching StarCraft Husky. No, it's just my voice is on the road to recovery. It's on the road to recovery. I'm able to speak properly now, which, well, sort of. I think I've still got this little bit of a rumble in the back of my throat, but everything else is fine. So let's jump outside the draft and look at this game. Hello Moto on the radiant side. I got Brewmother and Chen being banned out, so Splish Push Central being ripped out from the Germans. Actually, Kieta, hang on. Are they Germans or Swedes?
They're Swedes,
I thought so. I said Germans, I'm just like instantly in my head, like, that is not right. There is no way that could be right. They're just not that type of clan. But yeah, Brewmaster and CK being banned out by Kiana, so they don't want to see that CK in the mix again. Once again, yeah, we keep on seeing this, where CK gets banned out, it means Lycan's still in the pool as well, and it's kind of like this thing where we can take profit, we can take all these great heroes, Invoker's available as well. It's like, what do you really want to try and do?
Kita here are going to get the Lycan if Hello Moto don't ban it. Yeah. So they're sort of deciding. Like, there are three big pick heroes left. There's the Prophet, the Invoker, and the Lycan. Even Enchantress could probably be included in that group. But basically, Hello Moto decides here to take out the Lycan. So what they're doing is they're saying, Kita, you can have one of those other three heroes, but we're going to take two of them.
Mm-hmm.
So they're sort of trading off, and they want to decide what they exactly want to play against. And I don't blame them for taking out Lycan.
Yeah. All right, so it looks like we are broadcasting out. By the way, if you are listening in on Dota TV, it is great to have you here. Hoping everything is working out for you right there. In fact, I'm actually just going to double-check that right now.
I think it's working.
For the guys in the IRC chat who are watching on the live stream, or if you're watching on the live stream or watching inside the game and want to join the IRC chat of hashtag join Dota on QuakeNet, come and say hi to us as well. You've got a whole bunch of friends over there that love to talk to you.
Reserve time. Yeah, Hello Moto and Kira showed up in the live games on Dota TV, so it seems to be working.
Awesome. Fantastic. Absolutely fantastic.
Hello Moto here are taking a long, long time to figure out what their picks are, which I find surprising, because they must have known that Kita was going to choose one of the big heroes. And they pick up Enigma, so they're looking to control team fights.
Well, at this point, I think Hello Moto kind of realize, well, you get a control team fight, but Kieto's going to be picking up that Enchantress in the next selection. And that's going to give them a lot of early pushing power, so they need either something to help in the lanes early on or something that can help them counter-push. And Convergence, in a way, can do so.
Invoker's still in the pool as well, so I wouldn't be surprised if Kita... I mean, they could go for both of them.
Mm.
But I don't know, maybe... I don't know who on Kita plays... Oh, they pick up neither.
So screw the Invoker, screw the Enchantress, we're going to take ourselves the Lone Druid. As well as picking up the Shadow Demon. I really like these picks from Kieto. Doesn't really show much. Shadow Demon, he's always that great support hero that can work into any kind of lineup. And then you've got two heroes that can either run... Well, they can both run jungle. They can both run the hard lane solo. And, well, one can run solo mid, one can be farmed up on the top lane. It's a nice, diverse, just top three or first three out from Kieto.
Yeah, that reveals very little, whereas Hello Moto has revealed quite a bit. They're probably going to put Enigma in the jungle because they also picked up the Windrunner for the long lane.
Mm.
I mean, they can put Enigma in the long lane and put Windrunner solo mid, but I don't think that they're going to do that. I think that they've revealed at least a portion of their strategy here, which may be intentional to get Kida into thinking that they know what Hellamoto is doing. But I guess we'll see. But Hellamoto has been taking a long, long time on all these picks. I don't know if they're frazzled or if they really want to think things through to make sure they have the best possible lineup they can.
Yeah, they've got to get it right. For all those guys in the IRC chat, too, that just realized that I got the Dyer's name wrong. It still showed Dara from last night. It has now been modified, but thanks to the wonderful two-minute delay, you won't notice it instantly. It'll come up in about 2 minutes' time from you. So, yeah, for those guys out there in the IRC, go fix it. Yeah, it is, but you have to wait for it. Sorry. Hellamoto pick up the last one, which is the Morphling, and yeah, can't really disagree with the pickup. They still want their hard carry before the end of this one. If they want to run,
I think they're
jungle,
afraid. They're afraid that Morphling's going to get banned in the next phase by Kida.
Well, there's no real reason to be afraid of Morphling being banned. There are just so many options you can run on a hard lane for Hellamoto. Unless it's really working into that lineup, I'm looking to see Kida ban out the Crystal Maiden right now, because we have seen that combination from Hellamoto have used it. In fact, every team in Europe is currently using it, where they throw the CM and Morphling in towards the middle lane. And that'll let the Windrunner, if he wants to go top lane solo, he can do so. Or Enigma, he can also run that role, but jungle's better for him. But it just lets him mix up your lanes a lot more. And then you've got CM as well as Enigma. That's a lot of good early game aggression, which they'll need to try and bring down that lone druid, especially once he pops that level 6.
Even Morphling's a really good early game hero for being a carry. I mean, if you compare it to the other sort of popular carries that have been around for a little while, he's got a better early game than Lone Druid. He's got a better early game than the Animage. The only one that sort of compares to him is the Chaos Knight, who gets banned in almost every game in terms of the early game power.
It's still a player preference. Like Morphling, if you go the early E-Blade, then yeah, well done, you're aggressive. But you see these Morphlings who just get Lincoln Sphere. It's just so obvious that they want to try and win the game in 40 minutes plus, just because it's a very defensive item early on, but it makes Morphling impossible to kill unless you've got a crap ton of stuns. And Kieta don't really have that right now. That's probably another big reason why Hellamoto wanted to pick up the Morphling, just because of this. And I can't believe Dark's here, actually. We completely forgot about this guy. gets himself into that fourth ban position on Hellamoto's.
Yeah, it was AL's Darkseer that completely destroyed Hydra's Morphling by replicating himself.
It's good times, man. It's always good times. But this is one of these things where you're always going to have that in the back of your mind. We will never forget what happened that night. If you have forgot what happened that night, luckily we record VODs for everything. Even though some of them I know have been failing recently, big apology to the SQL guys if they're currently watching right now with their VOD currently having a mix-up from myself, so it doesn't exist.
Yeah, I think that here, Hellamoto, I mean, Kida has given them the CM if they want to take it, so I think they really should.
They should, man.
They can probably save it for their last pick if they really want to, if they want to secure something else first. I mean, there are two really good options to go if you want to run a dual lane with Morphling. And the most popular one is the Crystal Maiden, but one that also works really well and is not nearly as popular is the Lich. And that would give them both Enigma and Lich, which can be super annoying to play against.
The problem, though, with that is, like, sure, you might win the lanes early on, but once Lone Druid and once Prophet decide to push in, they don't need that many levels, and Prophet can pick it up from the jungle if he really, really needs to. And now they grab a Shadow Shaman. The pushing power of Kieta is really, really sudden, and Hellamoto, they can't just say, well, we've got double deny, what you gonna do? Because what they're gonna then do is just push down the T1, T2 towers
with
very little
that only
resistance.
Helps Kieta.
Yeah. You need the Crystal Maiden at this point. Or somebody's got counter push. Like Venomance might even be a nice option for them. That'll let them go for a little bit more lane control early on. And once they've got those wards up, they are still going to go with the CM. So I'm happy to see this aggressive line from Hellamoto. But you could have gone something with a little bit more passive, like a Venomancer with his wards.
Yeah, the Magic Immune counter push is very strong. But I think that Kida probably wants to push earlier than Hellamoto can defend. I think that's their strategy. I mean, Morphling's a pretty good counter pusher once he gets his level 4 wave form. I mean, he also sort of needs a mana regen item so that he can use it more often. Windrunner's got a little bit of counter push in the power shot when it gets up in levels, but I think that Kida are going to look to either force Morphling and Windrunner into the same lane and therefore share experience by pushing down that lane and force them all to defend, or they're going to take a tower because they can't be in the same lane.
Oh, I like this. I really love Rikimaru's. Rikimaru has not appeared really prominently in the competitive scene for a while now. And the main reason behind this is because people just realize buy a gem, have a half tanky kind of hero, and you can shotgun him down. But a Rikimaru that gets a really good start, Crystal Maiden, Enigma, Windrunner, they're all food. Even Morphling, to an extent, will become food with that Diffusal Blade. He won't be able to get out of the smoke in time. And the amount of damage he'll take is just going to be too much.
Well, and if you think about it, Shadow Shaman can just keep him in the smoke with Shackle or with Hex.
Mm-hmm.
But they can cloud the Sprout.
If they're going to go for dual ganks, that can work. Rikimaru, though, he's kind of like this solo kind of guy. That's why he likes to go invisible all the time. Like he shuns himself for the rest of the world and just disappears out. And he wants just these one-off picks. Like just to find one hero out of position and boom, down. It's kind of like what Klinks does when he gets the Orc with the Malevolence as well. So it works a little bit differently. But if you do want to try and shut down the Morphling, Gator definitely do have a lot of options with this one, and that's why we now see from Hellomoto they grab up a jungler, which is going to force Enigma more than likely in towards that top lane, which means Windrunner will take up the mid. And let's just jump ourselves inside the game, and well, actually, Hellomoto, their teammates start to appear, so I'll remove my little overlay from the top of that. We can get ourselves inside the game. Do you want to run through very, very quickly who's going to be playing a what for Hellomoto?
Sure. We got the captain. Ko Kava, I think that's how you pronounce it, playing the Windrunner. We've got PSTM on the Crystal Maiden. Everybody's headed top at this point, and we've got Sava Doom on the Enchantress. Likely to be in the jungle. We got Failitz on the Morphling, and Pimpalicious on the Enigma, who I'm guessing is going to be in the lane because they have picked up the Enchantress.
It would be a logical thing, but actually just judging by this, I got a funny feeling both Enigma as well as Morph, they might even stay top. It's no, that's not possible. I was thinking they might even try and run a dual jungle inside the Dire Jungle just to try and screw maybe with the Prophet or the Lone Druid. Both were options. But yeah, my brain is just screwing up with that one. How are we looking over towards the Dire side? We've got Wally to be taking the Rikimaru. Already looking towards that middle lane for him. Looks like Bonsai's can be supporting him as the Shadow Demon. Down towards bottom lane, Lone Druid, Nick Kwa will be taking him bottom solo. And leads Quicks up towards the top lane as the Shadow Shaman. And Chewie up towards the top lane playing as the Nature's Prophet. But he'll probably go, judging by his build. Actually, you know, his build's a little bit more aggressive. They got Tangos as well as Sounds, plus four Clarities. That's almost a half jungle and a half I want to gank everywhere on the map kind of build.
Yeah, but he's picked up his Nature's Call first, which makes it seem like he's going to go to the jungle. I mean, that's what I think is most likely with those the Treants first. And it looks like Morphling and Maiden are rotating to bottom, or maybe it's going to be Windrunner bottom and they're just looping around to mid.
And I like this little thing that Nick Guru is doing. He's holding his hero back right now on the bottom lane because he doesn't know exactly who is there. But he's put a Quelling Blade on top of his Spirit Bear, and it's just destroying off the entire tree line. So he can't get ganked on the bottom lane. Still makes it easy for him to push, and he'll slowly work his way through that line with the bear, and then we'll pull the creep wave up when he's ready for it as well. Just to get his timing right. And the timing's actually going to be perfect for it. He's already removed off half of those trees, so have a lot of vision to move around with. And then even chopped his way through with the bear so he can pull the creep wave out in an unusual position. And there's the aggro. And there's easy XP for the Lone Druid on the bot lane.
Yeah, it looks like we're going to have a quasi tri-lane with an aggressive Enchantress jungle in top instead of the Morphling Maiden in mid.
I love our two Bonsai just saying hello here to Quavja. I don't know if that's how I actually say his name. I just call him a really impressive Windrunner.
Yeah, it's got a lot of...
Oh, man, Shadow Shaman might be in a little bit of trouble. They will go for the trap and right clicks down. Crystal Maiden wants a Frostbite. And they're both taking up the tower while they're doing this, and CM cannot get in range for that Frostbite.
Morphling walked through the tower and basically cost him a salve for nothing.
Must have really thought that kill was going to be worth it. In the meantime, Windrunner trying to retreat out from War Leader, as well as this continuous harassment coming out from the Shadow Demon. He's really been on target as well, but then again, War Leader, he's been copping a lot of those power shots in the mid lane, just harassment from the Windrunner.
Yeah, she's really spamming them off, but she's got to be careful. She needs to save 100 mana at all times for Windrun in case she gets initiated on, like now.
Mm-hmm. She also doesn't want to pop it at that. Like, get initiated on that point, but if you use that, then you've got no power shot. You've got no way to harass from range, no way to add some pressure towards this dual lane in the mid. And you want to stay in there for as long as possible and get as much of a result as possible. And at this point, 3-0 is actually not too bad considering what she's going up against, but 8-2 and 1-1 are the heroes on the other side of the river, and 8-1 being on the Rikimaru.
I'm surprised that they've decided to pull here with Prophet. Because Hellamoto is looking to take down this tower. I mean, they've already done two-thirds, more like three-quarters damage. Sorry, yeah. One-quarter damage.
I think it's actually almost a bait. They start with a pull. That way the crew wave will come in range of the tower. Morphling might think, you know what, I can dive on this one. At the same time, Shadow Demon will rotate top lane with the double damage rune. But Hellamoto's got a ward watching his movement out of the lanes. So it's not as easy.
I think that this is a good move by Hellamoto. They've put a lot of pressure on top, which sort of forces Prophet and Shadow Demon to stay near, which then frees up some of the danger from the other lanes. So you don't have to worry nearly as much about Prophet TPing because he's got to sort of be near top to defend. And with Shadow Demon rotating up, you've also put a lot of freedom to the middle lane to farm a little bit more freely. Windrunner's already up at 10 CS.
Yeah, that's going to definitely help her out in the middle lane, but this is also, yet again, another one of those trade-offs. You start to look at it and go, well, Shadow Demon's leeching too much off the Rikimaru. They want levels up on him as well as the gold. You need to find a bit of a balance between the two of those things. As we just had a DC out from the Enchantress. But to get the levels as well as the farm up on Wall Eater, he's already got the initial stat, the poor man's shield, which lets him stand on that lane easy enough. And now he's up to the same level as the Windrunner. Windrunner, I should say, is up the same way. Then the farm's going to come out to Shadow Demon, because Shadow Demon's going to be looking for these consumables, going to pay for these wards, which are going to be pretty expensive for him. And probably going to start to pay for his items as well. And he hasn't really been having a free time inside that jungle, only up to level 3, and we're 3 minutes in, so that's pretty slow for Nature's Prophet. And the fact he's only just hit level 3, most Prophets, if they're sitting inside the jungle very early on, would be level 4, or maybe approaching the end of level 3 right now.
Yeah, he's just barely got level 3 at this point. Mm. But he's splitting experience, or at least he was, with the Shadow Demon, which is part of the reason why he's a little bit underleveled.
Again, it's that trade-off thing, man. We always talk about in the world of Dota, like, what do you really get when you change up, when you trade off one hero for another one? What am I really trying to claim out from having a Prophet? Like, what item is he going to try and pick up? Are we going to see Mech? Are we going to see Urn? Does he want to jump himself around the map? Because at this point, Chewie spent a lot of money on those Tangos and Salve, and there's been no one to really throw it onto. The pressure on the top lane hasn't been enough from the Morphling onto heroes themselves, so they don't really have to heal up too much. And down the bottom lane, Nikola's almost having himself a free time down there. He's now bought himself up an Orb of Venom on top of his bear with the Quelling Blade. So his right-click damage is actually quite easy to do on those creeps. And harassment on the Enigma's even better as well. And the Enigma, I'll just point out right now, he's down there on the bottom lane, 700 gold. Sure, he's getting a couple of deniers in, 3 of them to his name right now. But as far as blocking down the CS of a lone druid, he hasn't been successful. It's 15-1 on that lone druid, which is a dangerous, dangerous thing.
Yeah. From all the lone druid games that we've done together, it's been either lone druid gets his own way on bottom lane and he has such a great time and gets items really, really fast, or the enemy team throws a tri-lane at him or even aggressive dual lane and he's forced to stand back, not get experience, not get too much gold, especially if his bear goes down. And that really, really makes it a tough time. It sort of seems to be one or another. Lone Druid either has really good time or really bad time. I haven't seen a mediocre Lone Druid game yet.
It's difficult to be a mediocre Lone Druid. Like, all you really need, even if you end up going in, like, I remember Poppy's role, when all he did was just jungle, then look out for ganks, and just use his bear for an entangle rune. And 25 minutes in, he had himself a Radiance. So it was just like, well, what the hell's going on? He had nothing else, didn't need to buy anything else. All he wanted was the Radiance. It's just so easy to find a use for Lone Druid. The only problem is when his bear gets taken out, and then all of a sudden you find yourself with a Lone Druid who has no use whatsoever. It's just like, well, I'm sure there was a better key to this strat.
Yeah, getting the bear taken down is probably the roughest thing as a Lone Druid, because it's 50% of your damage and like 90% of your safety. So it gets really, really tough. And I think that when Lone Druids do get shut down, when they're playing this offlane role that they often do, when they do get shut down, they need to go somewhere else. We've seen so many Lone Druids just hang out at their tower and sit there and not really do anything. And I think that they need to, at that point, just give up on the lane, either switch with somebody else or go to the jungle.
Yeah.
Well, 'cause something is better than nothing.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. And actually, a jungle Lone Druid is pretty fast. The only downside is normally just getting your start up and making sure your bear can live through it all. He's about to lose his bear. In fact, he does do so. That's actually a big blow there for Nikwa. And Nimrod was able to kill off that bear. He's still got another 87 seconds before he can recreate another one. And this is our problem we were talking about. Lone Druid now just lost off the Quellian Blade, Ring of Protection, as well as Orb of Venom. That's basically 500 gold he didn't have before. Top lane, Shackles now going out in the Crystal Maiden, Disrupting going to follow it up. Chewie, think about right-clicking, and the catcher in the end goes on Morphling. He's going to wave himself up to be first blood here on the Shadow Demon. Two more right-clicks from the Morphling, there's one, there's two. So first blood being spelt by Phalanx for Hello Moto on the top lane.
Yeah, and I don't think that Kida right now have the levels to prevent this. Morphling is just has such a good early game presence, even just with the waveform. Combined with the Enchantress extra creep and Crystal Maiden going Nova and Frostbite, that's a lot of early damage compared to most other heroes.
Yeah. The really funny thing is, we normally talk about Shadow Shaman as the one you want to have initiate, but in this case, it shouldn't have been Shadow Shaman. It had to actually be the Shadow Demon. The Shadow Demon started off with Disruption, then to Soul Catcher. The response time from Hello Moto wouldn't have been enough. Then you'd have the Soul Catcher up on the Crystal Maiden, and the damage would then be pure onto her. And that's what they needed to do. Crystal Maiden is weak. She's only level 2, so bringing her down should not be that difficult. Now she's up to level 3 because of that kill, and going to gank up on the top lane. Shadow Shaman, Frostbitten up, and Phalanx with a waveform again. So another kill now for the Morphling on the top lane. And Kieta are losing control of this one. They just got to know where they've got to be, where the support's going to run. That's why I now see support also rotate middle lane. They realize this top lane is not working for them. They need Rikimaru to have that farm, have those levels, and have that control. What we got flying out to him right now, Wraith Band.
So he's going Aquila. And they get the tower for basically free in top. Kida at this point can't do anything to defend it. Shadow Shaman's only level 4, whereas the tri lane is. Every hero in that lane is almost at level 4. Morphling's at 5. The other two are well on their way through 3. And I think this is the trade-off that they're looking for. Is they've sort of given up on top lane. They're going to let Shadow Shaman do what he can, but they're focusing now on the Rikimaru.
Yeah, for Shadow Shaman, it's levels, and I think Alamoto have cottoned onto this fact. They want to try to look for the kill, and they're going to find it too. Double Centaur coming in. First off missing, however, gets a small shackle, but there's the Morphling wave out. So 3 kills now for the Morphling on that top lane. But Crystal Maiden, that's not where she wanted to be. Caught inside the trees. Now Wally is coming in for a quick kill. Smoke will go off, but still that sound popping up from Crystal Maiden and Sava Doom. Trying to get a little bit of space now. Wally trying to find from inside the smoke. Is he have to blink or do something right now? Chewie's going to TP him. There's a blink away by Wally to realizing the power shot was coming in from the Windrunner. A right click from Chewie.
Shackle.
Onto the range creep. Now letting up the Sprout. And Shock and Treants might be enough. Holding Morphling in range of that tower. He's trying to strength bolt himself through. Power shot again by the Windrunner. Doing what was needed. Morphling really low on life, but he's going to be thanking for that strength morph.
His stash is full.
What did he just buy? Okay, so he bought up Ring of Aquila, he bought his treads, and he finished off his magic wand. He really thought he was going to die during that one.
I'm actually surprised he made it through as well. Ricky had a really, really tough time. They needed to kill that Crystal Maiden super quickly, but she found a little nook in those trees there and was able to use her entire salve almost, and Ricky wasn't able to to see her or to hit her.
Oh, hello, bottom lane. We're going to see Enigma taking a fall. If Chewie can get one last right click, yeah, man, this Crystal Man's going to pick up a double kill. She already picked up the lone druid down here, and with one last right click, I was going to take an extra one through the tree. He's going to find it. Double kill for PSDM. They just profit being to pick up the last one.
And somehow they're finding kills on all the lanes. I think they've won all their lanes except mid, HM, that is. And they haven't really lost mid. It's sort of, like, even.
Yeah. The only way you can really class it, maybe this will do the job. Well, Smoke will follow up right now. But Windrunner, able to get herself away enough. Maybe she'll pop in the end. Yeah, she will. She will. She'll die. Maybe.
No.
Bottle charges will keep her up. Even with that soul catcher, Ball Leader wants to go again. And he can in a moment. Now he's out of range of the tower, but just popping out of Invis. And taking the creep instead. But that's just one of those moments where how do you really kill a Windrunner when she's got so much evasion? And now Haste Rune. Wally is going to make a move for it. Blinks and goes for her.
Oh, close.
She managed to bottle it as well.
And that'll really help because now she can get away even when Ricky puts a cloud on her. So she's got 2 minutes of safety here.
I think she's almost trying to be bait. Crystal Maiden's here. Crystal Maiden also up at level 6. This is a carry CM style. We've got 2-1-3 on the CM. She's got 3-1 CS. So carry CM with no farm whatsoever. And there's Wall Leader. Got to be careful if he gets frostbitten up right now, but he won't. He's out of range and also invisible.
And Morphling's getting harassed in bottom. Sort of trading some harass with Nikwa here.
Nikwa's going to be quite happy to do so. He's now bought himself up Tranquil Boots. So as far as harassing him down, works out beautifully for him. Savadoom, Wall Leader's going to find him. And Savadoom getting blocked up right now, so he knows something is wrong. Proper TP's in to help out. And there's the TP back out again. How much damage can you do? 168, but not enough.
Got the TP scroll off in nearly time. Close enough.
Need to get that Hex. Windrunner now from the top lane. Here. Yeah, they're looking for a kill with the Enigma. Enigma doesn't have a black hole. We're going to latch up the Rikimaru. Shackles on him. Following up stuns. Starts to pop off as well from the Crystal Maiden, but wonderful War Trap off from Quicks. But it's still not enough to save the Rikimaru's life. He's going to lose off his own life, but Crystal Maiden for the greater good. Shadow Shaman, one South Pop, and a Power Shot very, very quickly. Spread out to follow up by Nature's Prophet, but it's already too late. Teammate is dead. In fact, Windrunner doesn't want to let this go. Looking back behind the tier 1 tower.
They're thinking about that Prophet, but I don't think they can get it. And Morphling, meanwhile, has realized that he can't really stand up to this lone druid. So he's forced to go middle lane or wait for support. But all the support was in top.
Well, it's better for him. He can just harass this lane down. If he finds himself a Rikimaru, he can just replicate him out as well. Actually, no, hasn't gotten that points in. 4 points into wave, 3 into Morph. And he can also help control the runes. But no, he's going to go down bot.
Realizing he's going to help defend.
Lone Druid wants to push for the level 4 bear as well as Prophet. And then the Yoldi going to pop off too.
Here.
Yeah, they got to keep that vision on. But looks like Prophet popped it off on the high ground. And Wally is looking at the mid lane. I don't know if you have any luck there, man. Pimpalicious TP's down towards the bottom lane. Trying to
come
up
through. Black hole.
He's trying to come up through the trees to get a better vision. Crystal Man's here as well. Stun going out in Shadow Shaman. So the Enigma stun right now. And CN dropping down the Oldman right on top of Shadow Shaman's head. Got really lucky with that first hit as well. And now Nikwa. Being stunned up for a little bit, the bear trying to get in close so he can try and hold off that Morphling with an Entangle Root. But Imps flying out from Savadoom. Nikwa will not be able to escape from this one. Forced to turn himself around to see if he can kill off Failets. But not going to be enough in the end. Enchantress with the last right clicking.
These are really, really good TPs from HM support players. If you think about it, they seem to always be around when there's a tower that needs defending. They're always around when their carry's in danger. And now they can just turn around here and help push the tower. So it's great map awareness by the support players and the fact that they're always able to be where they're needed.
So it makes a great support player. I know Henry Dickinson was starting up a thread on the Joindata forums about it all. Well, it really makes a good support player. Where does the skill come in? When's the timing? How hard is it to really play support? And at the end of the day, also, like,
they get no love.
Yeah, support players are actually a harder role to play than hard carry sometimes. In fact, most of the time.
Well, yeah, if you think about a hard carry, at the end of the game, he's got, like, thousands and thousands of HP sometimes.
Oh, man, fail it. It's the luck of the first swipe with the Entangle. Nikko wants to keep on going for this one, hoping for another one. And now Prophet's going to TP in as well. He's waiting for that waveform so he can put off the Sprout, but the Sprout's just a little bit out of position. Which means Morphling's able to get himself away.
Yeah, that was lucky by the Morphling there. That Prophet missed that Sprout. So I think he probably would have been dead. He didn't have much mana to morph to Strength.
Sorry about that, just grabbing myself some supplies.
That's okay. In bottom, we had the wards go down by the Shadow Shaman just to put some harass on that tier 1 tower there. Enigma's there to clean up the wards and to prevent the tower from going down.
Mm. Got top lane TP. Chris the Maiden. I actually thought the Lone Druid was pushing that one. I was like, oh man, he's in trouble. No, it's good.
I really think that Kida here needs to sort of group up and force a tower to go down. But at the same time, they're scared of a black hole because...
They're going to be scared of Wall Leader going down the mid lane, man. He's already getting imped and shackled up. That one sentry ward really helped prep it for them. And now Bonsai in too close. Prophet will fly through, but the Enchantress imp will do the damage. And they pick up two in the middle lane.
Yeah, and this tower is going to go down here because of that. Mm.
The real problem for Kieta, like you said, maybe they should group up and try and take down a tier 1 tower. It's not going to work for them. They can't force push Hellomoto.
They need to bait out a black hole. I think that's the only way they can win a team fight. Because if the black hole goes down, they've got Enchantress using Impetus. They've got Morphling waveforming over everybody and then right-clicking. Enchantress has got a... Winrunner's got a power shot that she can put through everybody.
Even team fights can be difficult for them because you've still got Salva Doom's heal, you've got that Enigma Black Hole, which is a big enough problem as it is. There's just too much from Hellomoto. Kieta, what they really need to do is try and find heroes out of position. They need initiation. Mozo needs to come from War Leader, but he needs farm before he's really capable of doing such a thing.
He really, really needs to get that defusal before Hellomoto gets rich enough to afford gems and mass sentry wards. Because once they do that, his job is going to be a lot harder.
Well, at this point, I think we've already just seen from PSTM, carry Crystal Maiden, looking for a kill and says, well, why don't we just like group up, smoke up, and go through that jungle? Sounds like plan? Yeah, win, go. And I need support.
If you think
any
about
matter.
It, that's a ton of money for an early game Crystal Maiden. She's got two bracers, tranquil boots, as well as buying support items.
Well, it's about to be even more right now. If they're going to pick off Wall Leader, she needs that stun. There goes the stun. Now drop down the ultimate while Wall Leader shackled into a tree. Windrunner with a power shot, able to get the last right click out. But the Ursa are also helping out for that one, so Hellomoto, just keep catching Kieta out of position.
Yeah, and like I said, they have a sentry ward in mid, so it makes Ricky have a really, really tough time to go anywhere. Because you never really know where a sentry ward's been dropped.
Mm-hmm. And now Shadow Shaman. Oh, wonderful trap! Following up with the Shackles and the Prophet Ultimate. This might be enough, but that Strength Morph is real being a pain in the ass. Sprout holding off, and the power shot out from Windrunner. Catches up in time, and then locks Nature's Prophet into what was his dying Sprout. And now Enigma, Suns, Conversions, fighting within the Serpent Wards. Well, they do pick up the Morphling. It's going to be the price of the Prophet and the Shadow Shaman, and possibly even a Tier 2 tower on bot.
Now, hopefully here they can get Lone Druid to take top tower and at least get a trade. But I wouldn't be surprised to see Morphling TP up here in 13 seconds and try and push Lone Druid back. Yeah, here comes Maiden to top to try and help defend this.
Well, she gets her initial stun, then Morphling can take care of the rest.
She doesn't have any mana.
The bottom lane only needs three. She's also going to have no life points. Prophet's TP'd in for this one. Double TP comes in from Hellomoto. Chewy being stunned up and held in place while Crystal Maiden being entangled, roost up. Salva Doom now comes in. Pops the heal initially. And they're going to lock Nikora in place, but they need a stun. Adaptive Strike will stop that TP. Yet to know that was going to happen as well. Morphling waving over the top of that Spirit Bear. And Nikora, all they need to do is bring him down, and they do so. Salva Doom with the last point of mana he had. To pick that one off. In the meantime, though, Windrunner got locked out in the bottom lane. And they didn't
and
take
Enigma's
that tier 2.
Chasing the Shadow Shaman, or this Shadow Demon.
Look at his movement speed with those strike orbs. He's like, yeah, sup? I could run a crap load faster than you. Conversion. He might even Black Hole for this one. No stuns, just holding Shadow Demon in place a little bit longer. Will he? Prophet on bouncing through and doing a little bit of damage to Pimpalicious. And we'll force him back a little bit, and in comes Salva Doom. He's got one imp that will get the kill on that Shadow Demon, but he'll hold it.
And again, they put a sentry ward in mid just in case Ricky decides to farm there and they need a kill. So Ricky's got to be exceptionally careful and he's not very close to his defusal blade. He's got a blade of alacrity on the bird, but he's having a rough time.
Live
okay, CS, but three deaths to his name doesn't help.
Oh, well, either the smoke's going to come off. Do they have dust? Yeah, they got dust. Crystal Maiden didn't pop it. Now she does. See, Wall Leader run up high, Enigma will be here as well, Smoke will be there, but the Malifus done from the high ground, Wall Leader forced to come out of his own smoke, and then being right-clicked from both down low and up high.
Ricky can't buy a break here. Every time he runs into a hero, they've got some sort of true sight that they can pop down.
Well, that's the reason why Ricky Mario started facing out, as we said before. Oh, Raul, Windrunner, do you really have the damage for this? No, you don't. That backdoor regen's going to be too much. Now you're going to get hexed up. Trying to go for the cheap little swipe of the tier 2 tower in the bot lane. But, well, they make him pay for it.
And then they deny the tower. Cheeky play there by Windrunner. Would have been totally worth it if he had got the tower, but not nearly enough damage.
Well, for her, it would have been almost the full sheepstick. Already walking around with Mystic Staff and Voidstone, which Windrunner has managed to rush up in 18 minutes with a phase boost with a bottle. It's looking pretty nice.
But at the same time, Lone Druid is getting closer and closer to his relic. He's about 700 away now. He'll be much closer after this free farm in top. So Hellomoto is not... They haven't won the game by any stretch of the imagination. They still have a lot of work to do. Even though they're up in by 11 kills.
And also by about 8.5k gold, as well as almost 10,000 worth of experience. But yeah, Hellomoto have had themselves the best start they could ask for. Wall Eater looking for something else, but the Sentry Ward is there. CM dropping down the ult until we see Shadow Shaman really hit hard on them. Soul Catcher trying to go, and it will go on Sava Doom. Ward's going down as well, but Pimpalicious is going to pop off the black hole, pulling Cannon back in again, and even Shadow Demon walked into it. CM comes through with an over, power shot from the high ground, Morbling with a double kill. The damage is just too great, and Shui will DP himself out, realizing this is a lost cause. And again, a 2-for-1 trade for what was a really great initiation out from Kieta. But they wanted to push it a little bit further, and Hellomoto with that tier 1 tower support came fast.
Yeah, that's what Hellomoto's been doing exceptionally well all game, is they always have somebody there to help out. So even if Kieta finds a 2-on-1 fight or a 3-on-1 fight, TPs are always close by. And part of that is because they've managed to defend their outer towers so well. Kieta here is sitting on only a single tier 2 left in top lane. So their TPs are a lot further away when it comes to helping out in teamfights. Whereas Hellomoto can just TP out to right out to the river. Except for in bottom lane recently and top lane. But in terms of midfights, that tower is such good map control there. Because it allows them to respond so quickly.
So how do we look at this as far as individuals go? Because we're still going to keep our eyes on Nikwa. I don't know if you just realized, but he picked up his Sacred Relic during that top lane push before. So while he hasn't been involved in any of these fights, just keeps moving in through the jungle. And his Radiance on him is going to start to cause issues for Hellomoto. Because you've got to remember, the pushing power, we saw it very, very clearly. We have to wait for this sort of analogy. And it's they're going to go on the bottom lane. Windrunner being stunned up. Already being shackled after popping up the Windrun. She needs 4 staff or something to get away from this one, but will not do so. So 50 seconds on the sideline. That Medallion of Courage from Chewie really helped bring him down. But what I want to talk about is what Kieta can do once you have a Prophet as well as a Lone Druid Bear with a Radiance. That kind of split push which can come out from those guys can easily turn any kind of map control imbalance around for him.
Yeah, especially because they can drop down a ton of nuke on the tower with the Shadow Shaman wards in whatever lane they decide to push. And they're going to do Roshan here.
Mm-hmm. I like that little play as well from, actually, was that from Prophet? Someone managed to trigger off the shield. Crystal Maiden with the Nova. Now going to go over the follow-up on Nature's Prophet. There's the catcher. Pimple is just thinking about this, but he's got no ultimate right now. Crystal Maiden might have hers, but it won't be enough. Sava Doom pops up the heal. Trying to keep that bear off the tail. And back in towards Roshan does go down, and Shuri will take the Aegis. Nope, they'll give it to Nikwa. And now Entangled Root out on Sava Doom. Almost going to force Kieta in. They should not fight this one right now. This will not end well for them. Lone Druid's going to take
gonna
a fall.
Lose Aegis.
Enigma is currently into a chicken, maybe not. Nikwa transforming himself and popping off the boots in a moment. Shackle will hold off the shackles. There'll still be a CM for a Prophet.
He's just hiding.
Obviously, he's going to get himself out. That is so worth it for him to escape. Wall Eater was on the hunt as well. They pick off the Shadow Shaman on the bottom lane. And Wall-E is looking for that Enigma. It's obviously not a real one, though. That is a replica, but Wall-E is still going to feel like a boss for killing it.
And that turns out to be a 2-for-2 trade, which is one of the best fights Kida has had in a while. And saving that lone druid was very key for them. They don't lose the Aegis that they just acquired, and it allows lone druid to push a little bit harder because he has that extra safety net if he does get initiated on.
It's also bigger for Rikimaru. His defusal is really, really close now. And that is going to be a problem for Halomoto.
And if you think about it, Kida is going to get a lot of items really, really fast because they have the power to take down these four outer towers in a very short period of time. And that's like 4,000 team gold just there. So they're going to get a lot of items really fast when they finally commit to pushing. I always like to think of the outer towers as banked gold that you haven't withdrawn yet. So you've got start the game with 6,000 gold in the bank for your team, and you push a tower and withdraw 1,000. So whenever there's still a tower on the map, it's potential gold earned for your team.
The only thing you gotta make sure you do is push it in. I always see towers from a different kind of light. I see towers as, well, I need to push through those to get to the racks. And that means if I win a team fight, sure, I'm going to get a crap ton of gold directly after as well from the towers. But what happens after that point? Like, can I get through? Can I get a rank? That's my key objective.
Well, yeah, I mean, obviously to take down the Ancient is the final goal. But items along the way, I always see towers as a way to help you get your items. You're making a withdrawal and spending it on an item to help you then take the racks.
Wall-E just hit his moment. He might lose his moment in a moment. We've got smoke coming in for Halomoto. So all five smoking up. And we'll go for a little bit of a run into the jungle of Kieda. And they're going to find a lot of heroes.
Just picked up his Black King bar and has Black Hole off of cooldown.
The timing for the Undisrupted Ultimate. You got to try and find their pathing right so they don't get visible. They don't get spotted out. I love that one tree and just standing its ground. So, Halomoto.
That blocks the entire ramp.
Halomoto can't go up there. And Morphling waves up, and they're searching for Wall Eater. And they were trying to use a smoke to reveal him off. So the first person who gets revealed off, and Wall Eater instantly TPing out. That's too late. Halomoto. It's the only thing they've got right now to make up for what they just lost was to push that tier 2 tower on the top lane, and this will force the team fight. If Kieda wants to defend
it. HM here, Halomoto want to team fight because they just finished Black King Bar on Enigma, just finished Sheepstick on the Windrunner, and Morphling's had his Lincoln Sphere.
Yeah.
So Kida here probably wants to try and trade, but TPs are coming in to defend. Halomoto doesn't want to give this up.
That's a full trade, man. We got wards here in the middle lane. And it's going to be the tier 1 tower in the mid. Pimpleish towards the front line. Still looking for something, but very, very fast blink away there by Wall-E to getting back in range. And now Sentry Wall being dropped on. Dust as well. He's going to get stunned up and probably brought down. Disruption out there from Bonzo will buy him some time. So he'll be able to blink himself out to safety. He needs to get himself out of range of that ward so he can jump back to Invis. Still being dusted up. And the CM Ultimate Earn Charge will tick. But maybe not enough. In the meantime, in the bottom lane, tier 3, tier 2 towers already been brought down. Failers will come in, but then he gets entangled the second he arrives. And Chewy, with that Medallion of Courage, really dropping that Morphling down
entangled
fast.
Again.
Another entangled roots, and the Strength Morph up to 2,600 life. It's going to be too much right now, and Nikwa cannot beat him. He knows it too. He's got to get himself back out again. He's got a TP scroll, but being hexed up, being waved, and will be destroyed in the moment. Agassi model will pop, but he's in the worst position for it to happen. Still inside the base. Entangleroot on Windrunner, however, really, is he going to get this kill with Prophet Ultimate? He's going to get it, and he's going to get Salvadoom as well. Nikwa, he's doing full bamboo style, and then he's hoping for another Entangleroot, but he's on the run back out, sees an Eagle Song flying past him. And Morphling wants this. He really, really wants this. Prophet's going to TP in to help in a moment, and Nikwa goes inside the trees. Enigma coming up as well. Still got that BKB and Black Hole. Nikwa's still on the run, and Faelitz wants to keep going, but he gets blocked up by the trees until Pimpleish just says, screw them. Midnight Pulse gets rid of them, but he's just too fast.
Back in 5 seconds. So he could turn on this if he wanted to. He doesn't have any support from his team.
The support was enough for the Prophet Ultimate. There's that extra damage which allowed him to pick off the Windrunner as well as Enchantress inside the base.
That was actually really, really well played by Kida there. They make a play on the mid tower, watch Halomoto TP to defend, And then they run low druid into the bottom of the base, and they take out a base tower because everybody's TP is already on cooldown and they're fighting in mid. Mm-hmm. It's just the intelligence that they have to make that play, which allows them a huge opening on the bottom lane.
It's all, it comes down to the bait, man. You can try and take out Rax, but we have a prophet and a lone druid that can take out not only your tier 2, but your tier 3 tower in the blink of an eye while we're pushing your tier 1 tower in the mid lane. It's like, which one do you want to defend? Hellomoto decided to defend the middle lane and then split themselves down to try and defend the bot lane after they finish with the mid lane.
And that just didn't work out for them because they ended up losing the mid tower as well. I mean, it did get denied, which is helpful, but I don't think it's worth losing your base tower.
Well, it definitely is a man. And I think we're
now that lane's free. Next time that sort of same thing happens, Arax is going down.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's going to be that pressure which can come at any time as well. You got Prophet that can push out all lanes even when he's not even there. And you got the Spirit Bear with that Radiance Burn will keep doing the same job. Also notice too what Lone Druid's picking up. I don't know if he's trying to get a BKB for himself. But he's walking around with a Mithril Hammer unless it's a Deso for his bear. And it's actually in fact a BKB for himself. We got another BKB on the courier as well. Well, apart from the recipe. And Ricky Mara's, we've got Nogorax inside of his stash. We're going to have three BKBs coming up, and that's going to be Shadow Shaman's BKB.
And that's going to get really, really hard, because they're relying on Enchantress for a lot of her damage, and she does almost no damage when the enemy team is BKB'd. I mean, the only thing they can rely on here is to get the BKB heroes in the black hole.
Well, that's going to be easier now. We got a Blink Dagger up on Enigma. So Blink and BKB for him.
We have to remember that these BKBs are all at 10 seconds. Nobody's used their BKB yet on Kieta. So they're all going to be BKB'd for 10 seconds. Enigma, even if he gets a perfect black hole right when they pop, only lasts for 4 seconds. So they still got 6 seconds of magic immunity after the black hole. Which is more than enough time to kill Hellomoto here.
It's like Wolf is looking for an easy kill inside the jungle. Because now he's got that shoddy with Lincoln's Fear. He wants kills everywhere on the map he can find them. The one he'll find on the top lane is going to be the Shadow Shaman, who's only got 948 life points. And he's going to know if he tries to fight Morphing right now, he's going to go down, but he's thinking about revealing himself, and then the second Morphling waves, he blinks away.
I don't think Morphling could see him there, but he was scared and didn't want to take that chance. Devil damage.
Wall Eater's down there on that bottom lane. I think he's waiting for a gank, either on himself or someone he can kill.
He doesn't see any enemy heroes right now. They're sort of hidden in their own mid lane. As now they're revealed off, so he should feel a little bit more safety down here.
Yeah, they're gonna gank on Phalos on the top lane. So difficult to do though with that wave, and now going to replicate. Prophet's going to TP in as well. Just pops the Linker Sphere with his Sprout. We'll be able to do it again in a couple of moments' time. And there's the Entangle Roots. And wow, okay, that waveform looks a little bit weird with the animation.
Replicate.
And he gets back down. Supports the Pimpalicious is here. There's a lot more support. There goes the wards up, actually holding Sava Doom in there. So the Enchantress was enjoying that one to the point where she will actually go down. Shadow Charlemagne brought down as well, but Nikora is the one they really want. Morphling killing off the support hero at the back end of play. There goes the Adaptive Strikes. That picks off the Shadow Shaman. And now Crystal Maiden entangled up. Will she get through? Nikora being right-click down. Crystal Maiden will take a fall. They're still fighting within these wards, but it's going to be a triple kill for the Morphling. Double kill for the Lone Druid.
Yeah, that was an interesting choice by Kieta to commit to a fight there. They didn't have Rikimaru. He was back at base finishing his Black King bar. I think that if they did have him, it would be completely different. Mm. But it was overall a great black hole by Enigma there that secured them the kill on the Lone Druid. And meanwhile, Morphling was just in the back picking off the Shadow Demon.
Makes life easy, man. Makes life very, very easy for a Morphling when the rest of the main damage dealers being dealt up with are not in lane. All you gotta do is just jump yourself around and just like, yep, sweet, kill, groovy.
It was good of him to get that replicate off, even though it looked sort of funny. I think he went to the replicate, but was still entangled, which is why the entangling roots sort of got stretched there.
I got a moment right now looking at Pimpalicious. It's just one of these things where his hands are reached out. I don't know if he's just like, birdies on a rock. Birdies on a rock. Just so awesome, there's birdies on a rock. These guys here.
And we also see the Windrunners picked up a gem. So Rikimaru probably knows that. But it's just one extra thing that they have to be careful about.
So we get ourselves a resume. Hellamoto asking the question and hitting the resume button almost at the same time. We're wanting to get on with it all. With four people from Kieta dead, I don't think they're going to have any real...
Yeah, it's not like they're going to be doing anything for the next 10 seconds.
But Wally is still doing what he needs to do, and that's BKB defusal. He's going to look for a little bit more agility through his item build. And then he can start destroying people. Like that was a fight where Hellamoto really initiated hard there on Kieta, and it was still a 4v5 when you look at it.
Yeah. But they won, so that's good.
Yeah, obviously. What happens when Rikimaru joins the fight? And Hellamoto know when they got to push into the base and look for the racks. But Rikimaru will be there. In fact, Shadow Demon, hello. There's a Morphling. Wave up, shotties. Nice time for a disruption. They got to get that support there as soon as possible. Also, just triggering up the Lincoln Sphere. But it's just too easy for Morphling to get these kills and then jump back out again.
Okay, both teams know that Roshan's up. I'm actually surprised that Hellamoto didn't go for Roshan right after they won that fight. They had plenty of time with the enemy team dead that they probably could have gotten a good enough start so as to have killed it. But I think they're making a good play here for it, and I'm not sure what Kata can do.
At this point, they're just looking for tree blocks, and then Spirit Bear going to come in as well. Any damage you can do. Crystal Maiden starts to burn. Neck Charge will pop. Shadow Shaman's got himself a Blink Dagger, so they can keep the vision inside that pit. They might have themselves an opening, and there goes Roshan. Agassi model instantly picked up there by Morphling, who waves up and starts to really destroy on this bed. Does he have another one? No, he does not. Oh, this is a big loss. Hellamoto, if they work this out, Nick hasn't recreated one, so yeah, they're going to work it out pretty easily. Even if they get this kill right now, it's another 70 seconds before that Bear's going to be back up, so there's no Radiance for him. And Nikko will take a fall. Shackled and destroyed. And the line push from just from Orly is just like, I've got to go through the bottom. It's the only thing I can do.
We're going to look for a rack trade. Their base, so they're going to do the most they can to defend for as long as they can and try and take a rack here. Try and trade at the very least.
I don't know how much of the trade they can do. There's a semi-momentum there. Meanwhile, on the top lane, Prophet trying to do what he can. And he gets hunted out by the Morphling, and then jumps back to the Replicant in the middle lane. It looks like Hellamoto want to put the nail in the coffin here on Kieta. It looks like they're going to bring it back. They were 10k gold behind, and they brought it back by 7,000. And now BKB is up there from Shadow Shaman, but the right click damage is too much. Rikimaru doing a lot of damage as well. Now the Black Hole holding Wally to back in there. Morphling has actually got a triple kill, picking up the Shadow Demon in the back end of play. Now he wants Wally to. BKB is still there, but look at that right click damage out from Morphling. It's just too much. Enigma was the one with the kill. Ricky will buy back into the game, but the mid-rax is gone. It might save him from a double raxing. And that'll be all it will save them from, because that top and bottom lane is pushed out. And Hellamoto will want to clear off this mid lane as much as they can. Any towers, anything they can pull out. Wall Leader already putting out the smoke screen. It's like, you can come for our top racks if you want to, but we're respawning in a couple of moments' time. It looks like all Hellamoto want to do is bring down the tier 3 tower.
Morphling taking a lot of damage here.
He's still got the Agassi model, so he doesn't care. If he goes down, doesn't matter. And he can jump out to his replicate, Windrunner. She's getting caught out. Got to pop up that power shot. Decides in the end, may as well just TP because they're not going to stop her. No stuns left. And the bear couldn't get in for an entangle. And Enigma, I don't think you're going to be as lucky, man. 4 seconds before that Blink Dagger's off cooldown. Now 3. And being attacked by the bear is going to extend it even longer. Stunning the bear so he can get that blink off. Maybe 2 seconds. 1 second. Profit TP's in the front lines. And Nima will take a fall. Nothing can end this right now. And Rikimaru is the one to make him fall.
That's surprising, though. Kid had to work hard to even get that one kill as Hellamoto was retreating away. If you saw, they were... Like, the first, the Morphling gets out by going to his replicate. Second, the Windrunner uses Windrun, TP's out. Nobody can hit her to stop her. And then you've got this enigma who managed to walk all the way through the jungle and across the river.
Go, Wall Eater! He wants a cheap kill on the Crystal Maid. He's going to get it too.
He's got it.
That's that defusal power. No supports the food. And now no CM for this next engagement. For 50 seconds, she's out. Oh, man. Wall Eater overextends, though. And dies himself. He walks in range of the Windrunner gem.
He must have forgotten about it. Or not seen the Windrunner coming.
That's a big thing to forget about, man. Bottom lane, yeah. Chewie's giving momentum down there anyway. So if HelloMoto want to make the most of this Rikimaru death, they really can't. Like, you got Morphling as well as Savadoom pushing out the middle lane. And while that might have started to attack the tier 4 towers, they've got to go through the top or the bottom. That's their only real options. And they're looking at Nikora on the top lane.
Morphling and Enchantress are hunting the jungle for, I don't know who they think is there.
Anybody.
Maybe the Prophet.
They're going at oh, man. Going it through the back. How much damage can you deal? There's the bear. He's got 9 seconds before he's going to have to get himself out. He's got that replica he can jump to, which he does do so. And the Rax regenerated, so that was basically a run for nothing. Well, apart from forcing Kieta to get back to the
Windrunner at bottom.
Well, this is trouble. Shackles are up. They catch her out. Now the Sprout actually holds her around. It's a perfect surround. Need one last right click, and, well, would you believe...
The range creep got it.
Let's swipe the gem now. Creep. Prophet will take the gem.
And I think they should not put it on the Prophet. I think maybe they should deward with it and kill it. Because it's sort of risky to give that back when you have a Rikimaru on your team.
It's going to be more risky if they don't try and counter the vision on the map.
Yeah, they've dropped it in base. So at some point they will counter vision on the map. But for now they're...
Nope, he picks it up and goes. They know there's a ward up on that high ground. They want to kill it off. Because it was just too easy for Morphling to get away from that. It's like Morphling had to know.
They haven't spotted the ward that's in the base, though. Which is a key ward for HelloMoto to see who's defending the racks. And it actually gives a base ward in the late game actually is one of the best wards you can make because it gives you so much vision about where your enemy team is standing to defend and whether you can make a play to get onto the high ground in front of the racks or not.
Well, at this point, I think HelloMoto will feel like definitely can. You gotta look at that farm
off
the
Morphling. And they did find it.
They killed it off? Okay. Morphling. He's still got that replica.
Got a Scotty.
Yeah. His right-click damage is just so intense. And he wants to keep going here on the bear, and the bear can't get out of there if Velitz keeps on attacking him. Trees will be created, but trees will be destroyed as well. So that damage from Morphling is he's two-hitting every single tree. And now with the creep wave through the bottom, he can just right-click down this melee racks. They've got to get that disruption out in the Morphling. ASAP. And fortification is forced. Now the pipe will pop off as well from HelloMoto. Shotgunning down the Prophet. Then back in on Pimpalicious. They want to try and bring him down, but Crystal Maiden pops off her ultimate. Then the black hole right next to it. And it will be Nikwa that's been brought down by Phalanx. He's a big kill to get. And the Windrunner power shot will swipe it. But Shadow Shaman being brought down as well. This will be our official GG in a moment. Chewie ball bank for this one, but he is going to go down as well. And the top racks will be taken. There goes Savadoom. Ultra kill for Phalanx.
Wall Eater managed to pick up the Enchantress on the way out. Oh, he's going for the Maiden.
He's got to know that gem's going to be... Well, then again, was the gem dropped and killed? He's going to pick up the Maiden.
Oh, he got it.
He's going to die, though. He's invis again, but Phalanx just wants to waveform him. And he goes the wrong way. And the power show went the wrong way as well. But it's a double raxing. And you've only got the Rikimaru as the last one up. But he TP's bot lane. I'm going to do this the old-fashioned way. Or is he going to jump to the Replicant? He's going to jump to the Replicant in a moment. Look at it moving towards, towers now reveals, like, sup?
And it's invisible, too.
Uh-huh. There we go. Jump in. Shotty. Just destroyed. Pushes out the bottom lane a little bit. Now Wall Eater wants to go for him. Tries to blink, but the Lincoln Sphere gets triggered. And he's got 5,400 gold. We're going to see Rapier?
That's really risky. I think he's just going to go Butterfly. And he's almost at the point now where he only needs to Ethereal Blade the Shadow Demon. He doesn't even need to use his Adaptive Strike. So that's not the greatest situation if you're the Shadow Demon.
Support is a hard life, man, sometimes. I like the fact that Wally's managed to afford up a Yasha. 41 minutes in, still Yasha.
And then he's 7-for-7, so he's been getting more kills, but that bad start really hampered his ability to get the defusal up fast enough for it to be super effective and have a big impact on the game.
Mm-hmm. It's like quick swells Wally to go for a hunt. They want the more flick. Gonna realize that's not the real one. Gonna get the smoke units up towards the front lines and they can find the real one. Hearing Adaptive Strike going as on Chewy. He tries to trigger the Sprout, but two last right clicks. The gem is on the ground right there. Phalanx will kill it. Instead of picking it up himself because he has no slots for it, Quicks gets the Shackle with the Shock. Smoke up as well. Morphling. He's being held in place, so he can't. Really? Oh, he is too. Shadow Shaman gets brought down by that one. Aegis Immortal will come up and return Phalanx to his former glory. And now, Shackle only for a moment, but wave up and then right click. Ethereal Blade was still on cooldown for that one. But no one can really stand against this Morphling. And now he's going to see the Windrunner here in the middle lane. So, Ethereal Blade, waveform, power shot misses again. Wall Eater wants to initiate Adaptive Strike, and then the two right clicks from Morphling. Way too much.
Almost got that Windrunner. He was sort of gambling there.
There's the GG, well played. Yeah, to finally admit the defeat, considering it's a 24-for-1 Morphling. I think the timing was good for that. 339 CS as well. And Morphling will DC. He's had enough of this. As we do play on time ranking. So it's got to be a quick finish here by Hello Moto. If they want to get the best time ranking possible, 42-45. And more than likely, they're probably abandoned, so they may as well just continue and finish the game. There's just no way around that one. But Kieda, Londra was the only one left inside the game. And Nick was just like, yeah, just restart it. We're all good, man.
Yeah, and they pull the Morphling back manually.
And now that's one easy way to do it. Control off the disconnected hero and just make him right click. They already agimorphed himself and doing it with Star with a black hole. And just one big ass micro was the prayer to come out from Kieda. But that's it. That's GG.
Yep.
Hello, Mona, take it. 43:08 is your time on the board. And we'll be back here in a couple of moments' time, too, guys, for game number two from this evening. What that will be, actually, Ham, what is our next game for this evening?
Our next game is actually Na'Vi versus NextKZ.
Na'Vi versus NextKZ. Man, should be a good game. Stick around if you want to tune it, if you want to check it out. Obviously, your live stream will be right here. We'll be back in a moment, guys.
I said good day, sir!